Alexander Hamilton, one of the boldest of our founding fathers, exercised a profound influence on America's destiny. Today, the destiny of the only home Hamilton ever owned is one of shameful destruction. This historic house in New York City has been kept open only by heartbreaking efforts against overwhelming financial obligations. With continued public apathy, the home so poignantly associated with this great American, a house comparable in historic importance with Mount Vernon and Monticello, will be lost. That it is a doomed shrine into which we must enter to relate our story is a disgrace to the citizens of New York. Broken glass panels flank the doorway, which opens into one of New York's few remaining federal period houses. Built in 1801, it was called the Grange in deference to Hamilton's Scottish forebears. Hamilton's life here was short and tragic. Despite the manner in which it has now deteriorated, his natural discernment is still in evidence in this country mansion. Visitors of that time praise the famous octagonal drawing room. In the hallway, the work of the Italian sculptor Giuseppe Caracci, fashioned of Hamilton as Secretary of the Treasury, stands in solemn dignity, ignoring its shabby surroundings. The Grange hasn't been painted in 38 years. The dining room shows the disintegration perhaps more than any other room. Hamilton's impeccable taste provided a scene of gracious living which must be recreated. Resourceful plans have been made to move the mansion from its crowded site, rehabilitate and handsomely furnish it so that it can provide the nation with the worthy symbol of our American heritage. We must have faith that this will be accomplished before restoration is impossible. It is ironic that lack of financial aid threatens the existence of the home of the patriot whose genius laid the financial foundations of our country. This was Hamilton Grange as it appeared on its original site. Hamilton lived here from 1802 to 1804. He planted 13 trees as symbols of the beloved country he adopted. For Hamilton was born on the island of Nevis in the West Indies and spent his boyhood on the island of St. Croix. Hamilton moved to St. Croix in 1765 when he was 8. This beautiful island tropic paradise is now one of the American Virgin Islands. Hamilton lived with his family on one of the many plantations whose romantic ruins still dot the island. Left an orphan at the age of 11, Hamilton's future looked unpromising until he was employed as an apprentice clerk in a mercantile firm. He proved a commercial prodigy with unlimited abilities. In 1773, in order to further his education, Hamilton sailed for New York in the rebellious British colonies, a fateful decision. He entered King's College, now Columbia University, and wrote a series of letters and pamphlets supporting the revolutionary movement. In 1776, at the age of 19, Hamilton fought bravely as an artillery commander in many early battles of the war. This led to his four-year tour of duty as aide-de-camp to General Washington. His subsequent actions as an infantry commander greatly contributed to Cornwallis's surrender. Hamilton was present at this ceremony, which, in effect, marked the end of the struggle. But the new nation had yet to be born. Hamilton worked with unceasing persistence to bring about the Constitutional Convention. Slowly but surely, the document was forged into shape. On September 17, 1787, it was presented to the convention. Hamilton urged every delegate present to sign in order to show a united front. Then he wrote his own name as the only representative of New York State. It can be seen center screen above the New Jersey delegates. Collaborating with James Madison and John Jay, Hamilton wrote the brilliant Federalist Papers. These outstanding works on the principles of American government were instrumental in the Constitution's ratification, in the creation of the United States as a nation. As our first Secretary of the Treasury, Hamilton's gift for far-sighted economic thinking created the solid basis of our financial integrity. He He spent the last night in the Grange in this study. It evokes memories of the anguish of spirit he must have undergone as he contemplated his fate. Memories that are brought sharply into focus today. One of these pistols had killed his son just 3 years before, and Hamilton vowed to meet Aaron Burr without firing at him. The infamous duel had come about as a result of an accusation by Burr that Hamilton, in public print, had impugned his honor. At 7 o'clock in the morning of July 11th, 1804, on the dueling grounds of Weehawken, New Jersey, Burr and Hamilton faced each other. Two shots rang out. Hamilton, who had involuntarily fired into the air, fell with a mortal wound. Thus died the man whose deeds are perhaps most indelibly impressed upon the foundation of our nation. The man who dedicated his life to guide his country toward its destiny as the greatest republic on earth. Across the Hudson River from this tragic site, nestled between the skyscrapers of Lower Manhattan, is Old Trinity Church with its adjoining graveyard, where lie the remains of Alexander Hamilton, the patriot of incorruptible integrity, the soldier of approved valor, the statesman of consummate wisdom, whose talents and virtues will be admired by a grateful posterity long after this marble shall have moldered into dust. Hamilton's story is ended, but what of his home? The news magazine feels confident that New York will not close its doors permanently, that the Grange will be restored as a fitting tribute to that great patriot who made such significant contributions to America's heritage.